Good morning and welcome to the sixth meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2021. We're joined this morning by Alex Cole-Hamilton, who is not a member of the committee but is attending due to an interest in the proceedings. Can I welcome Alex to the meeting and invite you to declare any interests relevant to the committee?
Thank you, Convener. I have no relevant interests.
Thank you. Murdo Fraser and Alex Rowley are running slightly late and will be joining us shortly. The first agenda item this morning is a decision to take item 4 on the consideration of evidence heard in private. Are members of the committee agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. We are agreed to take agenda item number 4 in private. Moving on to agenda item number 2. This morning we are taking evidence from a panel of stakeholders on vaccination certification. I'd like to welcome to the meeting Professor Christopher Dye, FRS, Professor of Epidemiology, University of Oxford, Professor Stephen Riker, Bishop Wardlaw Professor of Social Psychology, University of St Andrews, and Professor John Drury, Professor of Social Psychology, University of Sussex. I thought it might be helpful to start by giving a brief recap on the vaccination certification scheme. The Scottish Government announced its intention to introduce a vaccination certification scheme on the 1st of September. The Scottish Government's intention is for the scheme to be in place by tomorrow. The committee intends to listen to the views and to feed them back to the Scottish ministers directly in our regular evidence sessions with them. Any issues that you raise today will also inform our scrutiny of any relevant legislation that is brought forward to give effect to the scheme. As such, your input is very valuable to this committee, and we're pleased to hear from you to receive your written evidence. I wonder if I could please start by asking the witnesses, what are your key priorities that you think should be embedded within the proposed scheme to make this work? Could I start with Professor Dye?
Good morning, everybody. I hope you can hear me and possibly see me as well. I'm attending this session, I think, because of the work that we did at the Royal Society some months ago now. But the purpose of that was to lay out what we felt ourselves and through consultation were the main criteria for using vaccination passports. And I circulated in advance of this meeting the report that we produced, and we came up with 12 criteria in detail, but they really fall into three main categories. First is, are vaccines technically good enough? That is, are they protective enough? Do they do medically, clinically what we want them to warrant certification? And I think it's clear that the answer to that question is yes. So that was the first area. The second was, is it possible practically through means of software and hardware to actually set up a system that would, for example, guard people's privacy in a way that has concerned many? And there are many debates around this, and perhaps we'll have some of them in this session, but broadly, my answer to that question would be yes, it is possible to do that. The third area is perhaps still the most contentious of all, and that is the issue of whether COVID passes or COVID vaccination certificates can be set up in a way that is fair. A certification scheme is intrinsically discriminatory and exclusive. That's the very nature of it. But can we set up a system that is broadly regarded as being fair? In other words, a system that really does what we want it to do. It does the job of giving peace of mind to individuals who are attending collective events, let's say they're going to restaurants or bars, nightclubs, sports events, whatever it may be, gives peace of mind to those who are organising those events and to community overall. And I think so we laid out the criteria. We weren't expressing an opinion about whether they should be used or should not be used. Our goal was to lay out the criteria under those, broadly those three headings, but there are 12 points in detail, as you can see in our report. But my view of the situation now, some months on, is that COVID certification is a feasible and helpful process by and large, although we haven't ironed out all of the difficulties, but by and large, it's a feasible and successful approach, an approach which adds force to our central approach to controlling COVID nowadays, which is through vaccination. So it reinforces vaccination. And in this regard, I read with interest the report that was circulated to us yesterday evening, the evidence paper. And I must say, with one or two comments and queries, I broadly agree with its recommendations. I think it's a very good report, actually. And I agree with its basic recommendations, which is that vaccine certification is a useful device, a useful approach to support the vaccination program in Scotland. Just a couple of queries. I mean, one is why in Scotland the system has decided to focus on vaccine certification only, whereas most of the other schemes that I've encountered, I'm speaking to you from France, where I live mostly, especially during pandemics. Why the Scottish scheme focus only on vaccines and not the other two instruments that have been used, that is negative testing or a prior confirmed episode of coronavirus, COVID-19. So that's one question. I don't quite know what the answer to that is, although I can perhaps guess. The other thing that's missing perhaps in the report is, to my eyes anyway, is a discussion about approaches to care homes, clinical settings and hospital settings, which I didn't see mentioned. But those are two smaller points. Broadly, that's my overview of where we now stand on certification.
Thank you, Professor Dye. Could I ask Professor Riker what he feels are the key priorities that should be embedded with the proposed scheme?
My sense of the vaccine certification scheme and vaccine certificates more broadly is they are very much a double-edged sword, and how they work is very much a function of social trust. So in areas of so high social trust, where people believe that the vaccine certification schemes are there for them and to help them and are a public health intervention, by and large what it does is it takes, if you like, the vaccine indifferent. Those people who are not anti-vaccine but haven't got round to it, it gives them a good reason to get vaccinated. And therefore, when you introduce such schemes, what you see is quite often a surge of people getting vaccinated. That's certainly true in France. But in countries and in communities where there is low social trust, they can have a very different impact because they lead to a sense of compulsion, that the vaccine is mandatory in effect. And when you try and impose things on people, number one, you get psychological reactants, people reassert their autonomy, and secondly, it undermines their relationship with authority. And indeed, we have data to show this, that in high trust individuals and communities, you find that the prospect of vaccine passports increases the intention to get vaccinated. Whereas for those who have low trust in communities, such as the Black community, where you have low trust, it can actually not only have no effect, it can actually increase opposition. So I think the evidence paper we were given slightly understates the problems. It says, well, perhaps it won't have much of an effect amongst those who are in have low trust. Actually, it can lead to greater opposition. So that's one problem, and the issue of social trust is a major problem. The second issue is that what does it do to other behaviours? Now, early on in the pandemic, when vaccines were first introduced, there was some data to suggest that those who were vaccinated were given an illusion of immunity and vulnerability and increased their risky behaviours. And so what you get on the one hand from vaccination, you lose on the other by an increase in risky behaviours. So very much the issue of how you message is really important. Now, that has a number of practical implications. For me, first of all, the broader context in which you introduce vaccine passports is critical. And I think that they only work where you are doing other things to increase social trust, especially around vaccines. So I think it's really important not to see vaccine passports as your sole strategy to increase vaccination. They have to be seen in the context of increasing the ease of getting vaccination, making it easier, making sure that vaccine stations are in schools and colleges and universities and workplaces and communities. And secondly, that you engage with people, that you listen to their concerns, that you take those concerns seriously, that you answer those concerns. There are other things that you must do to increase trust. One, for instance, is to have a very clear set of end criteria, because otherwise you feed into those narratives which say this is about controlling us, this is the thin end of the wedge of ID cards. So you need a very clear set of criteria of when this will be taken away. This is not going to continue. This is temporary. I also think it would help to have, if you like, a conscientious objection clause, that there is a procedure by which people don't have to get this if they don't want to. Now, I think not many people are likely to take advantage of that, so I don't think it would be a major problem in terms of numbers, but at least it would show that this is not imposed upon you, you don't have to do it. So I think those issues of how you introduce such a scheme are critical. And the other point is messaging. I think the messaging is absolutely critical. It's really important to say to people that you are not invulnerable, that that vaccines make you safer, they don't make you safe. Because as I say, if behaviors change, then you undermine the advantage of the vaccine. And the final point I would make is this. I mean, I also felt it was a very impressive document, the evidence document. But I did think, as I've already indicated, that it understates the risks. It understates the importance of messaging, but it also understates the alternative. One of the points it makes, I think this is a really important point, it's not made prominently, but it's a really important point, is vaccines are crucial for making us safer, but they're not enough on their own. We also need other measures like improved ventilation, improved hygiene, and indeed the research on even large events in indoor spaces shows that if they are properly ventilated, and if there is proper hygiene, actually levels of transmission are very low. So it does seem to me that vaccine passports, as I say, are a very double-edged sword. They create problems. They alienate people from authority. I think there needs to be much more emphasis on making venues safe, making them necessarily safe, and having clear criteria for the opening of those venues. Because I don't think the alternatives are between vaccine passports and closure. I think they should be between vaccine passports and safe venues, or indeed perhaps vaccine passports and safe venues. And I don't think there's enough emphasis on that in the document, or indeed in the discussion more generally.
Thank you, Professor Riker. Could I ask the same question to Professor Drury, please?
Yeah, so I think I'm here because I conducted the systematic review, the only systematic review that's yet been carried out of possible behavioural consequences and social impacts of vaccine passports and other forms of COVID certification. And my priorities are in terms of psychology, behaviour and social impacts. And I would say they divide into three areas. And the first, has already been mentioned, is in terms of possible social exclusions. As has been mentioned, by definition, vaccine passports exclude some. But the question is, who do they exclude? Because the criteria, of course, is vaccination. And you only have to look at the vaccination data. I mean, consistently, there is a pattern. The groups behind others in terms of getting vaccinated tend to be those who are more deprived and those who are black. And they will be the ones who are disproportionately excluded by such a scheme. So that would be have to be a consideration, either recognising that or trying to mitigate in some way for that. The second priority I'm concerned with is in terms of take-up and backfire effects. Because, of course, one of the arguments for vaccine passports is that they might encourage people, incentivize people to get vaccinated. And there is mixed evidence for that. I mean, anecdotally, for those countries that have implemented these schemes, there is some evidence that there has been surges in take-up. I mean, you have to take into account these are very different cultures. I mean, Denmark is a good example where they've been successful. They've got very high levels of public engagement with testing and with vaccination, but they also have very high levels of trust, much higher levels of trust in their authorities than we have in this country. So there is some evidence that a scheme like the one being proposed would lead to an increase in take up. And I note in the report that there is some evidence that the prospect of the scheme led to a surge in vaccination take up in Scotland. But there are also these possible backfire effects. And we started to, when we did our systematic review last year, we started to think about that. We started to notice the sort of circumstantial evidence, because most of the studies, of course, were carried out before vaccine passports were introduced. And so they were survey type studies, experiments, a bit hypothetical, but there was a suggestion, a hypothesis, if you like, that this could happen. And since the review was published, there have been two studies that I know of that have shown this kind of effect. And I think one of them is cited in the report. I'm not sure about the other one, but then we've got much more firm evidence that this can happen by a backfire effect. I mean, some groups harden, instead of becoming motivated to get vaccinated, they harden in their anti-vaccine view because they construe and understand the scheme as a form of control. And it tends to be the same groups or people in the same groups that are not getting vaccinated. So these two issues, social exclusion and backfire effects, they interact. And there's a related point to this, which is it might be beneficial for COVID for our response to COVID to introduce such a scheme, make many more venues and activities possible. But if this backfire effect does occur to any degree, the concern I have is with the long-term relations that those groups have with authority. I mean, part of my research background is in public behaviour in emergencies and in how the public interpret and respond to different interventions by the professional emergency services and the authorities. And where there is a poor relationship, that relationship can be damaged by interventions, and that the consequences of that could be long term. So what I'm saying here is that there might be consequences for future engagement with the authorities. So, I mean, for example, one of the studies in our review found that if you made vaccination mandatory, then people were less likely to be motivated to take a subsequent vaccine. So there are these knock-on effects. The third the third concern I have, probably less important than the other two, but there is this evidence that vaccination and vaccination passports can provide a false reassurance, and you know, one of the mechanisms they would be achieving that in this case would be the sort of dichotomization of risk, because instead of a continuation of risk, I mean, a sophisticated understanding of vaccination is that it reduces your risk, it doesn't eliminate it. But with vaccination passports, you've suddenly got a dichotomy of those who are able to engage in certain activities and those who are not, creating and supporting the impression that there is a fully safe venue and other venues that are unsafe. And we do know that there is this notion of risk compensation, whereby people do change their risk-related behaviours, their precautionary behaviours after some vaccination. So that is a third possibility.
Thank you very much. Before we move on to members, we've been joined also this morning by Graham Simpson, MSP, who's not a member of the committee, but is attending due to an interest in our proceedings. Can I welcome Graham to the meeting and invite you to declare any interests?
Thanks very much, Convener. I've got no relevant interest to declare.
Okay, thank you. Can I move on to Murdo Fraser?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, and my apologies for my late arrival due to a train being cancelled this morning. Can I maybe just start by picking up the comments just made by Professor Drury there about the issue of backfire effects, which I think is very interesting, because it seems, you know, counterintuitive that if you introduce vaccine passports, you'd expect that to encourage take-up, but your argument is that there is some evidence that it might have the opposite effect with some groups. And I think that's worth exploring a little bit further, both with yourself and the other panellists. And I wonder if I could ask two questions around that that might help form the discussion. Firstly, would it assist with those groups you're talking about if the vaccine passport scheme had an end date? Would that make any difference? And secondly, as an alternative to vaccine passports exclusively, would it make a difference if, as has happened, I think, in some other countries, there was an alternative to using testing at venues, so people could either be double vaccinated or produce a negative test? Maybe Professor Drury could start with yourself.
As I mentioned, there's a couple of studies that show these backfire effects now, and it does, as Professor Reicher pointed out, it is associated with existing levels of trust in those groups, and it is to do with the meaning of the scheme. I mean, I guess to some extent we can manage that meaning, but sometimes those meanings escape our control, and you know, if it's the authorities who are trying to reconstrue the meaning of the scheme and present it as something democratic, but the authorities are the ones who are not trusted, then there are some limitations there. Certainly the question of end date is important, because by setting an end date, you're working against that possible narrative that these things are about control. And I understand that some of the schemes that are already existing, they haven't set end dates, and I think that is problematic. So in order to increase trust, you would want to have an end date. On testing, I mean, testing is one of the alternatives. I mean, in my submission, I mentioned this, and I know that there are practical problems why testing might not be included. So if it's self-testing, you've got the issue of self-report and people being honest. If it's testing for getting into venues, you can't test everybody getting in. But testing is actually, I mean, on the one hand, people's engagement with testing is subject to the same demographic variability as vaccination. So if you look at the evidence for the mass testing programs, for example, in Liverpool last year, you find that, again, it's deprived groups, it's ethnic minorities who are not coming forward. On the other hand, testing is far less controversial than vaccination. It doesn't have the same connotations for those who are mistrustful of authority. And you can imagine a one-off testing scheme being more acceptable to people. So I agree with Professor Dye that, you know, I'm slightly surprised that it wasn't included, because it is the perhaps more acceptable alternative to purely reliance on vaccine passports.
Okay, thank you. Professor Dye, can maybe ask you the same question?
Thanks very much. I think the first thing I'd like to say before answering the question directly, actually, is that we've already heard in the conversation this morning about the pros and cons of certification. And what we're ultimately dealing with is the balance of those pros and cons. There are adverse effects that have been documented, and Stephen Reicher and John Drury have outlined many of those. I think the important question is, are they dominant in any situation, such as to outweigh the advantages of using certification? And where they're important, how can we directly compensate for them? That's something that Stephen Reicher said, and I completely agree with that. On the two parts of your question, an end date. Around the UK, where I'm not at the moment, I'm in France, but there's been a slogan, data, not dates, and there is some merit to that. And how that translates here, I think, is that my preference would be not so much for an end date, which might have to be rescinded, but rather for an end criterion. And once we've reached those criterion, we would then remove it. That would give assurance that this is not a permanent method of control, but the intention is to release it. But I think that would be a better criterion for doing so. On the alternatives to vaccine certification, I think John Drury has just covered that very nicely, actually. But it was my surprise, too, when I read through the documents for this meeting, that the Scottish intent is to use only vaccination and not the other two backup methods that are used most widely in COVID passes around Europe, namely a negative test of some kind or previous evidence of an episode of COVID, implying that one is the subject would be immune in some regard. The advantage of a tripartite system like that is that it provides a backup for those who really don't want to be vaccinated or who cannot be vaccinated for medical reasons, and it therefore factors into that third aspect of fairness that I spoke about in my introduction. A reason for excluding those other two options might be in Scotland. I don't know what the reason is, but I can think of a couple of possibilities. One of them is that it increases the incentives for getting vaccinated, of course, which is ultimately what we would like from a public health perspective. But there may be also some cost aspects to this as well, particularly where government is providing a free testing service, a rapid antigen test or a PCR test, which is a cost to government, which they may not wish to bear. So that might also be another factor. But as I say, I don't know the reasons for that. But across Europe in general, the tripartite system has been broadly agreed, and that's what's been adopted by the EU. So the Scottish system, a consequence of that, incidentally, is that it would not therefore be interchangeable with a European COVID pass. And with regard to travel and movement, I think that would be a considerable disadvantage.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Dye. And the same question, please, to Professor Riker.
To understand the backfire effects, I think it's important to place what's going on in a broader context of what are the influences on people's behaviour. And it's not just that people are being subject to information from government telling them to get vaccinated. There are, of course, other voices. There are anti-vax voices which are telling them not to get vaccinated, telling them that vaccines are a problem, that vaccines are a form of control. It very much is part of that broad populist politics which says, you know, the system is trying to control you. And so people are positioned between these different voices. And the question is, what does one do to make sure that the voice of government, the pro-vaccine voice, gets traction and the anti-vax voice doesn't get traction? And of course, one wants to avoid doing anything which will give traction to those anti-vax voices. So we've got to look at these things in that context and be aware of the fact that there are those voices out there. And one of the problems is precisely that what vaccine passports do is they give traction potentially to the argument that vaccines are about control, and particularly amongst groups who historically have concerns along those lines. I mean, the reason why you get more vaccine hesitancy amongst the black population isn't because they are stupid, isn't because they are backward in any way. They have historical experience of this being a reality. If there was a report to the House of Commons and House of Lords, I think a couple of years ago, which showed that something like 70 or 80% of the black population felt that the health systems did not take their interests into account. So there are these historical beliefs, and the danger is that if you feed into those, then something like a vaccine passport is more easily interpreted as about control and therefore leads to more resistance. And so you've got to ask yourself, okay, how do we undermine that sense of this is about control? What are all the levers we have in order to do that? So certainly end criteria, and I absolutely agree. I mean, data, not dates, was also a slogan in the UK, sometimes observed in the breach, especially in England, but nonetheless, it's a key slogan, and I think it's a key slogan here. It has to be about criteria. I think dates, well, we've seen how they can backfire. I think, as I say, there are other things you can do as well. I mean, first of all, I would argue that we need to, again, look at the broader context of building trust. Building trust is so essential in so many ways in this pandemic, with engaging with communities, with not treating people who have doubts and questions about vaccines as if they are fools, as if they are ignorant, as if they are selfish, but taking them seriously. So I would argue, in a sense, that's absolutely central to any scheme must be that it's done in a context of building trust more generally. If you just have vaccine passports and use them as an alternative to the community engagement, that will increase the backfire effect. And as I say, I think a conscientious objection process would also be helpful. I mean, it wouldn't be something that people could do just by ticking a box. I think it has to be a process so that that if it's a matter of convenience, it's actually easier to get vaccinated than to opt out, but it would show that you can opt out if you do actually want to opt out. So as I say, building trust, undermining the narrative that this is about control in the way you message, in the way in which you have alternatives, in the way you introduce the scheme is absolutely critical. The final thing I would say about testing, and here I agree with the others, is in one sense, it's very simple. People, especially if they're self-testing, people will not test positive if they can't afford to. We saw right at the beginning with the schemes on mass testing in Liverpool, there was far much less take-up amongst poorer sections of the community because they couldn't afford to find that they were positive because they couldn't afford to self-isolate. The evidence from the events research programme was very clear about this around the Euros, and they found that the Euros led to a large spike in infections. And one reason is with self-testing, why would you go to the length of making sure that you test well if that makes it more likely that you test positive, which means you can't go and see the game? So the problem with testing is that self-testing is not very reliable if the effects of a positive is to stop you doing the thing you want to, and it is rather practically inconvenient to be tested by others. So there are difficulties, but I still accept the argument that those different options, again, are part and parcel of undermining the narrative that this is about control. So if you are going to introduce these things, I would include all the various possibilities, even if it's less about a matter of practicality than a matter of messaging very clearly that vaccines are for you and for your health. They're not imposed upon you and about controlling you.
Thank you, Convener. In view of the time, I'll leave it at that.
Thank you. Yeah. Alex Rowley, we've got about 10 minutes each.
Yeah, thank you. I've noticed the messaging coming out of NHS 5 in the last few weeks has been very much, if you have any questions, if you're uncertain at all, we have people to discuss. So picking up on that point, Professor Rachel, I think I picked that up. Is there any evidence, or have you come across any evidence of where these schemes have been introduced in Israel, across Europe, and some states in America, where there is actually concrete evidence that shows that has led to an uptake in vaccines? And really to that question, I mean, the UK does seem to have good uptake, and the government in Scotland seem to highlight particularly young people and seem to be aiming at young people. But is there other best practice out there that we can build on in terms of trying to encourage those who have not taken the vaccine to take it? Any of the panel? Professor Reacher, do you want to start?
Okay, so thanks for that. They're very good questions, and they're very challenging questions indeed. Early on, one of the first examples of a vaccine passport scheme was the Green Pass scheme in Israel. It's got lots of publicity and lots of positive publicity. But some of the literature coming out of Israel suggested that actually, in terms of the take-up, it wasn't simply to do with the Green Pass. And indeed, the Green Pass was often not being scrutinized, not as effective as it might have been. But actually, there were very impressive community engagement schemes in Israel. And Israel, in many ways, pioneered the philosophy of don't get people to come to you, go to them. So, for instance, there were vaccination stations outside the bars in Dizengoff, in the middle of Tel Aviv, for young people to go to. And people would be given something to eat and something to drink, not alcoholic, but they'd be given something to drink to make it attractive to do that. So in many ways, the uptake in Israel was as much to do with these forms of engagement. Secondly, it was one of the first things that the WHO said. I mean, if you go back to January, the WHO said that community engagement must be at the center of any vaccine rollout. And indeed, historically, there is plenty of evidence. We wrote a piece in The Lancet looking amongst the black community, showing how community engagement schemes were effective. Now, actually, there are many, many such schemes. As you say, there's a large amount of very good work. If you go to the website of the Royal College of General Practice, you will find hundreds and thousands of such schemes up and down the country. I think it would be better if that was the focus of the national campaign and it was nationally coordinated. But I do indeed think that they have been very effective up and down the country. And as I say, I would echo what the WHO said right at the start, right in January, that community engagement must be at the centre of any vaccine rollout programme.
Okay. Professor Dai.
Thanks very much. Perhaps I'll just speak from the French experience, because France is where I live and actually operate in neighbouring Switzerland, which is quite similar too. We know that the French experience is that a number of people, particularly a vocal minority, expressed reservations about vaccination and have continued to do so. But we also know that that's not the majority sentiment in the population. And when President Macron announced in July that vaccine certification, or rather the pass sanitaire, as it's called in France, which is the three-part COVID pass, was going to be mandatory for access to many venues, a million people signed up within a few weeks to get vaccinated. And most of those people were people that Professor Reicher has referred to earlier on as not anti-vaxxers, but just those people who didn't feel the need to get a vaccination. And then they did feel the need to get vaccination. And so a large number of people did sign up, and that has been very effective in boosting vaccination coverage in France. So in France, the system has worked, and in my perception, it's worked pretty well. There are very few complaints about the COVID pass and how it's used in France. It's just become, and very quickly become, a routine fact of everyday life, along with mask wearing, where it's obligatory. People just do it. They do it every day, and they don't complain about it. So I think in France, it's been a success. And that leads me on to the other remark that you made, Mr. Rowley, in your introduction, was about good uptake of vaccines. The question is, what is good enough in terms of vaccine uptake? And one thing that we've discovered in the last months of this pandemic, with the emergence of new variants, is that we're going to need very high coverages of vaccine in order to keep COVID at very low levels. So the initial assessment of perhaps 70% coverage would lead us to cross the herd immunity threshold is now generally viewed as being too low, and we're going to need higher vaccination rates. So vaccination rates are good, but we need the vaccination rates, in short, to be as high as possible. And COVID certification is going to be a way to help that. Just one final remark, if I may, about your very first point about what kind of support, and it goes on from what Stephen Reicher was saying as well, about the need to support those people who might be excluded for one reason or another. I think this it's not good enough in this regard for this to be passive support. In other words, putting out an announcement saying, please contact us if you have problems, because the people who have problems are not the people who are going to contact you. I think what's needed is a much more proactive approach to those people who feel they're excluded, and to work out the reasons why they're excluded and ways of compensating for that. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. And Professor Jury?
Yeah, just to add a few points to what's been said. I mean, in the Israeli situation, yeah, it is regarded as an example of success. As Stephen Reicher said, there's a confound there with the community engagement program, which included things like working with trusted leaders. So, you know, trust was important again. In my initial remarks, I mentioned Denmark, and again, a success story. They have, as far as I understand, now abolished their passport scheme because they've had so much success. But as I said, very high levels of trust in that country, very good levels of engagement already with the vaccination scheme and with testing in that country before they introduced the passport scheme. Italy, I read, reported that vaccinations increased by 15% after they introduced their scheme and made it compulsory, and similar reports in Netherlands. Although I have to say, a lot of this is anecdotal, and I haven't seen any sort of peer-reviewed evidence from those countries. And one last comment about this, because I think Professor Dye's point about attitudes in France is really interesting, because I think we're all aware that at the beginning of their scheme and before the scheme came in, the very visible opposition. I mean, I will acknowledge, and this came through in our systematic review that we carried out last year, there's various dimensions of variability for attitudes to vaccine passports. We've already talked about population demographic variability. So different groups have different attitudes to vaccine passports. There's lots of evidence that the purpose to which the vaccine passport is put to is another variable. So public support for vaccine passport schemes tend to be much stronger for international travel, much weaker for activities such as going to work. And then you've got other activities which are in the middle, including leisure activities. But the other dimension along which attitudes vary is time. And one thing that was quite clear when we looked at the many attitude surveys that have been carried out on vaccine passports last year and this year, is that attitudes change and they become more positive, they become more negative. And one of the factors actually that makes them more positive is implementation and rollout. It does tend to be associated with greater public acceptance. Though, you know, that's still not to say that there isn't going to be, a rump of people. And, you know, the question of is it worth it boils down to knowing how big that rump of people are who are still oppositional, and the consequences of that opposition for later public health engagement and interventions.
OK, thank you.
Can I move to John Mason?
Thanks very much, convener. There's quite a lot in there. Can I ask Professor Dye, perhaps, first of all? I think you mentioned people who couldn't be vaccinated. Now, we've been given a suggestion that that would be less than 1 in 1,000. Can you comment if that's about right or what?
I can't give you a precise figure, but yes, I think it's the minority, a very small minority from a medical perspective. But I would echo what the others have said in this regard. Just because they are in a small minority, they shouldn't be ignored. Yes, in terms of balance, it's a very small number of people.
Okay, thanks very much. Professor Reicher, you mentioned, I think, conscientious objection, and I'm interested in how that might work, because can somebody just say, well, I object to passports and therefore I'm not getting one. I mean, presumably they would still be excluded from going to, you know, a big football match or a nightclub or that kind of thing. Or would you say that they should be counted as exempt, just like somebody who's medically exempt?
Yeah. So let me go back to the logic for that, because in terms of the impact of vaccine passports, I think we've got to distinguish between the short-term effect. And the short-term effect is generally positive because it leads those who I call the vaccine indifferent to think, well, I might as well get a vaccine because it's more of a hassle not to get a vaccine. Okay, these are people who just haven't got round to it. And so that's why you see the surge. The danger is that in the longer term, while you win over the vaccine indifferent, you consolidate the opposition of those who are already doubtful. And I think that's important not only in terms of social exclusion, because those, as John Drury has pointed out, tend to be rather marginalized groups in our society. It also, in a sense, has a biological implication, because when you talk about herd immunity, one of the problems is we talk about herd immunity as if the population is homogenous. So if 90% of people are vaccinated, that's evenly spread. If it's unevenly spread, and you have some communities in which there is much lower levels of vaccination, that means that you have pockets in our society where the vaccination can still spread, where new variants can still come about, and therefore poses a major problem. So even if there are only some communities in which there is lower levels of vaccination, it's still very much a problem. Now, that relates to conscientious objection, because if the great advantage is in terms of the vaccine indifferent, then you won't undermine the vaccine indifferent taking up the vaccine if you have conscientious objection, as long as the procedures are such that it is easier to get vaccinated than non-vaccinated. But at the same time, for those who are doubtful, for those who think it's control, it says to them, actually, there is a way out if you want it. So it could have an advantage that you still win over the ones that you can win over, but you don't alienate the ones you don't want to alienate. And in order to achieve that, I would say that actually, if you choose to go through the process and be a conscientious objector, then yes, you can still go to venues and so on. In other words, it's a device in order to undermine the narrative of control. And so to have the benefits of the vaccine passport system as a whole without the problems.
Okay, others might follow on that, I don't know. Another point, I mean, France has been mentioned a few times as a comparison, and they seem to have a much wider scheme in the sense of much more services you would need to have a certificate for. And I just wonder, does that make a difference? Either can we be more relaxed because we're saying it's only for a very small number of high-risk luxury kind of items, or is the advantage in France in having it wider is that it's become more widely accepted? Maybe Professor Dye, because he's there.
The reason why the French scheme is more comprehensive is, as I recall, because it was introduced at a time when a new resurgence of COVID was beginning during the summer, and the government decided that they really wanted to use all means at their disposal to control that new resurgence. And they decided, in effect, to take few risks. In other words, to be more comprehensive about the way in which the vaccination program was done, backed by the COVID pass system. Subsequently, I think for that and for other reasons, case incidence has now come down to relatively low levels. That reminds me to say, I think what's been absent from this conversation so far, we've talked about balancing risks, but of course, whether and how certification is used depends on the epidemiological circumstances of each country. Where there's no COVID, of course, there's no need anymore for any certification process. And that was the point that Israel almost reached earlier this year. The situation, of course, you have to translate these comparators that we're talking about, France, Denmark, Switzerland, and other countries. you have to translate that into the Scottish epidemiological situation at the moment, which is less favourable. Cases, as I see the data, cases are now coming down, but COVID is still at pretty high levels in the UK, and because it's at high levels, I think there are stronger arguments, therefore, for reinforcing the vaccination programme, strengthening methods to improve coverage, of which certification is one part. May I just also comment on a conscientious objection? The difficulty I see with that, I offer this just for discussion, is that whether or not you're permitted to object depends upon the circumstances under which you are operating. So, to take an uncontroversial example, in medicine, for example, doctors doing surgery have to be vaccinated against hepatitis. You cannot be a conscientious objector if you are in medical service to not having that vaccine, because that simply is too high a risk for everybody concerned. And I think the same will be true under COVID certification as well. There are circumstances where people can simply opt out if they want to be objectors. They don't have to go to nightclubs, for example. But in medical settings, clinical settings, care homes and so forth, the community at large might take a different view of that. So I think that's a difficulty with the idea of conscientious objection. Thank you.
Thanks for that. And that actually leads me into my final question, which I'll maybe aim at Professor Drury, if I can start with. This idea that although the government or the parliament is only intending this should be for nightclubs, big crowds, that kind of thing, presumably employers or other venues could use the system to, as part of their entry requirements as well. And I mean, is that a good thing or a bad thing? Are there risks with that?
Well, the first point I'd make about that is one of the groups we haven't talked about are those who work at these venues. Yes. So I guess one of the arguments in favour of vaccine passports is it could make frontline workers safer, like people who work behind bars, because they are exposed a lot. But it's interesting to bring up the question of employment. I think I mentioned at the beginning, look, if you compare public attitudes on vaccine passports across the different activities that they allow or disallow, then the activity that is most supported in terms of vaccine passports is international travel, and the one that is supported least is in terms of your ability to go to work. And in Israel, they did include going to your workplace in the scheme. And there's some evidence there that led to conflicts as some people tried to get into their workplaces and weren't able. I wonder if I can sort of broaden this a little and address this question of the scope, because we have touched upon that in the last response. And I think it is quite interesting the scope of the proposals in Scotland compared to other places. And on the one hand, you could say, you know, as Professor Dye said, that the activities, the types of venues included, are the ones where people have got relatively high choice, and therefore, you know, maybe you could say that the possible exclusions for certain groups would be less severe because they're not necessarily everyday activities, such as going to the pub or going to the shops. On the other hand, I was quite interested to see that as well as nightclubs, which, you know, are indoors, you've got outdoor events included. And that's slightly paradoxical, perhaps, because as we are all aware now, outdoor events, you've got fresh air, you're much less likely to be infected. And we did talk briefly about the events research programme earlier. And it's useful to consider the evidence from that and other evidence that has been brought to bear on the question of people's attitudes towards vaccine passports for live events and people's engagement with vaccine passports and similar live events. There was a survey carried out by an agency in the live events industry earlier this year, and they produced a very high figure of support for their, basically it's people going to live events, very high levels of support. But they framed the question as all biometric testing, right? So that was picking up not only vaccine passports, but again, testing for immunity as well. So it's the broad range of tests. So there is broad support for that. And if you look at the events research program, there's considerable variability in outcome, which is consistent with Stephen Reich's point that it seems that you can operate live events, outdoor live events, and minimize risk of infection without a vaccine passport scheme, but with other things instead, because they picked up relatively low levels of infection at Wimbledon and relatively high levels of infection at other events, such as the Euros. And two of the key variables that seem to matter are, one, how the event was managed, but two, the behavior of participants and the culture, the levels of intimacy, the levels of physical proximity, whether people were shouting. And both of those things, this is the key idea, key point, can be modified. And this is the logic and the rationale of a scheme that certifies venues and events as an alternative or a complement to a vaccine passport scheme.
Okay, thanks so much.
Thank you. Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Gavina. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for coming in to give evidence. I think where I am with this is I'm trying to establish really where the evidence base is for the not just the introduction of the vaccine passport, but the way in which the Scottish Government have introduced it. I think that one of the things that concerns me is that we seem to be comparing Scotland with what's happening in other countries and trying to pull lessons from other countries. But of course, there's a huge variation in vaccine uptake across across these countries. And so there's a variation in the need to encourage the uptake of vaccines. I think my first question would be is that comparison, the way in which we're comparing the Scottish vaccine passport scheme with other schemes in other countries, really an accurate measurement of the way in which we should be adopting vaccine passports in Scotland? I could ask that to Professor Riker initially, please.
So comparison with other countries is both the best of worlds and the worst of worlds. It's the best of worlds in that we can learn much from what's happened elsewhere, but it's the worst of worlds if the comparisons are made mechanically and they ignore the key parameters which differentiate between countries. And the key parameters, it seems to me, are both, if you like, biological medical, incidence rates, as Professor Dye has pointed out, that's a major factor. The need for schemes is there only if you have high rates in the community. And at a social level, I would come back to this absolutely critical role of trust. Social trust is a key parameter. These things are understood in very different ways and have very different implications in different countries. And Professor Drury made the point that Denmark, where they've worked well, is a high trust country. The Scandinavian countries have the highest trust, both in government and people in each other, of any nations in the world. There are surveys, there are world trust surveys done every year, and you find that systematically. So the comparison must take those two factors into account. And it shows us that in whatever we do around this pandemic, the central issue for me as a psychologist, as a social scientist, is about the building of trust. You can give all the information to people you like, but if they don't trust the source, they're not going to listen to us. And again, going back to the fact that what actually we're involved in is a battle between ourselves and the anti-vaxxers over information, we will win that battle to the extent that there is more trust in us than there is in them. And anything which atrophies or undermines trust, I think, is corrosive, not only in terms of vaccination, but in terms of any measure that we need in order to deal with a pandemic. So just going back to the question itself, yes, let's take international comparison very seriously, but only in the context where we are aware of the key parameters which differentiate between countries. And as a social scientist, that key parameter for me is trust.
Okay. I wonder if either the other two panellists would like to add anything to that before I move on. Professor Dyer?
Yeah, thanks. I agree with what Stephen Reicher has said, in that international comparisons are important to make, but they are limited. The difficulty is that we don't know how much of what goes on in France or Denmark or Switzerland or any other country applies directly to Scotland. In other words, the decision that is being made now with regard to certification is going to be made in the presence of uncertainty. I think that's a key point. We're never going to have all of the information that is needed. And the question, therefore, is what decision should be made given a certain amount of evidence, but plenty of uncertainty? Is it the political decision to err on the side of caution and strengthen the vaccination program by using certification? Or is it the decision to err on the side of less caution, more risk, if you like, and not introduce? Well, it seems that the decision has already been made, as we heard at the beginning of this committee, that the intent is to introduce this scheme tomorrow. So I guess that decision has already been made. But what follows on from that uncertainty is the need to follow up with data collection and information to understand how successful the introduction has been, both with regard to the practicalities of what's acceptable and not acceptable, and we spent a lot of time on that, but also on the epidemiological impact as well. So really important need for continuing collection of data and information to see how well this scheme is working. Thank you.
Thank you. If I could move on to my next point, I think the introduction of the vaccine passport scheme, the Scottish Government have said the main driver for that is trying to encourage those who haven't been vaccinated yet to take up the vaccine. And as we heard in evidence last week, and also I noticed Professor Riker's evidence, one of the key issues here is around those groups who are reluctant to get the vaccine, and that in ethnicity is one of the big drivers, that especially around our Polish and African communities, and also those in areas of deprivation. Now, I'm just wondering, you know, this idea that you need to be vaccinated to get into nightclubs or football, these groups appear to me unlikely to be participants in those particular activities. So I wondered whether or not you consider that the way in which the vaccine passport has been introduced will help these groups do what the Scottish Government want them to do, which is get vaccinated. And I will ask Professor Drury, since you haven't spoken to me yet.
Hi. Well, can I first make a sort of broader point about evidence? Because I think it does bear on this question, but it frames everything we say, really, because how can we be confident in the arguments we're making? International comparison is one set of evidence. We have four different types of evidence for, you know, these backfire effects, for vaccination take up, and so on. International comparison is one. We have survey evidence, self-report evidence. We have experiments. I mean, experiments and surveys might be based on self-report and rather artificial, but they provide relatively consistent patterns of the types we've been talking about. And then we've got the vaccination rates and the demographic differences I talked about. And these are all we have. This is a lot, but this is all we have. We don't have randomized controlled trials, which is the gold standard, but we still need to make decisions, and we are making decisions. On the specifics, I don't have any evidence on the groups you mentioned, I'm afraid, so I can't really talk about those two. And I guess, you know, what we need to do is understand the existing attitudes of those groups to answer that question.
Professor Riker?
My dad came from Poland during the war to join the Polish Air Force in the UK. You should have seen my dad when there was football on. The Poles are quite interested in football, and the black community is interested in football as well. But in terms of data, we have some unpublished data, a study I did with one of my master's students, and that showed reasonably clearly that for black participants, the introduction of vaccine certification for large events like concerts, like going to the football, led first of all to a greater sense that vaccination is about control, being done to us rather than being done for us, and led to lower intentions to get vaccinated. Now, I absolutely accept all the provisos which John Drury has just pointed to. This is experimental data, it's self-report and so on, but I would also echo what he said in terms of it being consistent. So as I say, the point is here that you have, especially amongst the black community, a community in which there is traction for a narrative which says that we are not well treated by authority and that we are controlled by authority. And therefore, anything that feeds into that is more likely to be read in those terms and lead to more resistance. It is also consistent with the evidence. So for instance, if you look at evidence on vaccine hesitancy, overall, there is very little vaccine hesitancy in the UK. Only 4% of people are vaccine hesitant, but then you look at the smaller communities. So if you look amongst the unemployed, it's 14%. If you look amongst the Muslim community, it's 14%. If you look amongst the black community, it's 21%. So again, you see these much higher levels. And as I say, for me, that's not only a social problem. I mean, it is a social problem. It's a major social problem. But potentially, it is also, if you like, an epidemiological problem, because it means that you have potential reservoirs of infection in this country, and you will never get herd immunity while those reservoirs exist.
Professor Dyer, would you like to add anything to that?
Yeah, I would just like to add a comment about the purpose of certification. You mentioned that the main purpose is to increase incentives for vaccination, and it says that in the evidence report as well. In fact, I think it's equally to protect health and stop transmission, because it controls, I use that word advisedly and hopefully carefully, it's a way of controlling the transmission of infection at the events that we're talking about, the mass gatherings that we're talking about. So I think it is about incentivizing vaccination, but it's also about protecting personal and public health.
Okay, thank you. Just finally then, given that, as has been highlighted here, that the specific pockets of our population that are less likely to be vaccinated, what should we be doing to encourage that uptake in vaccination? I'll go back to Professor Dye if I could.
I think this is a difficult one to answer very specifically, but I think all I can do is reinforce all of the things that have already been said. I think it starts with not being dismissive. Perhaps I'm stating the obvious here, but it starts with not dismissing people who don't want to be vaccinated as fools, and stronger language has been used under many circumstances. But My knowledge of the behavioural literature is somewhat limited here, but the studies that I do know of, which have investigated the reasons why people don't wish to be vaccinated, discover that, of course, it's not one single reason, but there are four, five or six different groups of reasons in different communities. So we have to start with that understanding of why people don't want to be vaccinated. We may say it's irrational, but from their perspective, it could be fully rational. And very reasoned. Unless we understand those reasons by working with those communities, we will not be able to persuade them. And that goes to the point about messaging as well. It's not just messaging per se, it's messaging that is effective communication with the people who are on the receiving end of those messages. So I think in short, we have to understand why people don't want to be vaccinated. When we do that, we'll be in a better place to increase vaccination rates.
Thank you. Professor Riker.
I mean, there's a very long answer to that and a very short answer. And the short answer is community engagement. It's going to people. It's listening to people. It's respecting people. It's allowing them to have doubts and to go away and come back to you. It's very much about treating those who are vaccine hesitant as not them, but treating them as perfectly reasonable people who have real doubts. I think it's another thing that's really important is to distinguish between different populations. So the first thing is that if you look at the number of people who aren't vaccinated, it is far higher than the number of people who are vaccine hesitant. Okay? Because most people who are not vaccinated, as I say, are the vaccine indifferent. They haven't got round to it. They're the ones you can capture more easily. The difficult ones are those who are vaccine hesitant. They have questions, but they're fundamentally different from anti-vaxxers. Anti-vaxxers don't have questions. They think they have the answers. They know the vaccine is wrong. And the danger is if you treat the vaccine hesitant as if they are like anti-vaxxers, if you lump them all together, the danger is they will become lumped all together. So as I say, if you want people to see you as on their side and to trust them, you've got to treat them likewise. You've got to respect them if you want them to respect you. So that's the first thing, engagement. The second thing I would say, and again, it's a very simple philosophy, don't wait for them to come to you, go to them. Making it so much easier to get vaccinated, setting up vaccination centres in communities, giving people time off and paid time off to get vaccinated, using community champions and so on. So all those things, it seems to me, I would put those at the start of my debate about how to increase vaccination rates. I wouldn't have it as an add-on after vaccine certification. And the final point I would make, and here I absolutely agree with what John Drury has said. In many ways, I think it's the most important thing that has been said today, that if we're concentrating on certification, then certification for individuals creates all the problems we've been talking about. Because once you have certification for individuals, you've then got to have forms of scrutiny and surveillance to make sure that they've got vaccine passports and so on and so forth. You introduce all the problems of what happens when you have to stop people and ask them to show passports, all the problems of alienation we've talked about. We ought to be laying, it seems to me, equal, if not greater emphasis on certification for venues. Because if the venues are well ventilated, if they have high hygiene, then they are relatively safe. And not only is there evidence about that, about large events outdoors, there was a recent large study in Nature showing that even indoor large events are relatively safe if they are well ventilated, if there is high hygiene. So if you had certification for venues, that they have to meet particular standards before they can welcome individuals, it seems to me you have many of the advantages without many of the disadvantages. Now, I'm not saying it's neither or, you can have both, but I would say, yes, if you're going to talk about certification, do it in the context where you've put much, much, much more work into community engagement and into certifying venues. And in that context, where you show you're acting to protect people, again, you're likely to get far more trust and far more traction for the narrative that the vaccine passports are about protecting people rather than taking away their freedom.
Thank you. Professor Drury, just to give you the opportunity to add anything to that if you want.
Yeah, just briefly, as Christopher Dye said, usually incentivization is not the main rationale for schemes like this. I know it's been mentioned by many policymakers, but it isn't usually from a sort of public health perspective. It's usually about making spaces more safe. And just to echo what Stephen Reicher says, hesitancy is only one reason why people are not getting vaccinated. If you look at successful public health campaigns around the world, they've all been based on community engagement. I mean, I've read some inspiring campaigns, accounts of inspiring campaigns in relation to AIDS, in relation to Ebola in some countries. And on top of community engagement and building trust, there is the practical side of facilitation, which means people are sometimes reluctant to come forward and get vaccinated because they expect to be sick for 2 days. So give them paid time off work. They're sometimes reluctant to get vaccinated because the vaccination centre is out of town. So bring the vaccination programme to them. That's what they did in Israel. That's what they've done in some local authorities. And the final point is about the different groups, because if you look at the attitudes and the views of different groups who are not coming forward to be vaccinated, you find particular concerns. And one of which, I was at a seminar yesterday where some new evidence was being presented on this, and it is often amongst young women with concerns around pregnancy. So that's a specific concern that needs to be addressed in a community engagement programme.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm just conscious of time. We've got 15 minutes before one of our witnesses has to leave. Jim Fairley.
Thank you, convener, and welcome to the panel. I'd first of all like to know, are we talking to Stephen Reicher or Reicher? So that's the first thing, because we keep hearing different names. I've listened really carefully to a lot of the stuff that's been said. I've read the papers, and I have to say it's a hugely confusing and conflicting conversation. But I've drawn some conclusions. First of all, we know that the virus is endemic. I'm going to quickly run through these conclusions. The virus is endemic in the population. We know that it kills people. The targeted scheme is working because we are getting an uptick in the numbers of people who are going and getting vaccinated at the moment. We know that the vaccine reduces infection by up to 50%, as we've heard in a previous session. The virulence of this Delta variant is much higher than we've heard in a previous session. The post-vaccine and passport requires a strong messaging to continue with hand washing and masks, because of the false reassurance that you have spoken about. Largely, the Scottish Government are trusted on what they've done so far, and this scheme has a sunset clause on it, and I know that there's a debate between time and data. Events and venues, to me, don't transmit the virus. People do. And by and large, the nightclub industry in particular have worked incredibly hard to make themselves as safe as they possibly can. So I would argue that I take the point that you're making about venues and events, but I would argue that it's the people that transfer the virus, not those events. So I've got a couple of questions. Conscience objectors have a choice. You're right, they can absolutely make the choice that they do not want to take the virus, take the vaccine. This is a targeted scheme, so they don't have to go to the events that they are going to be excluded from by not having the vaccine. But allowing the access, if we follow on what you said, Mr. Reicher or Reicher, by allowing the access for conscientious objectors to go in, aren't we then taking away the rights of the people who are in the event or in the place? Are we not actually discriminating against the business owners who are saying, if you come in here, you can put other people at risk and therefore cause us a problem? And I'm going to go on to a question I've asked on numerous occasions now. Care home workers in my constituency have actually been sacked by a care home owner because the staff won't take a double vaccine, and they've balanced the rights of the residents as being more important than the rights of the workers. And we've discussed that at length. I think that's something we really need to delve into. And that comes back to the question, whose rights are more important, the conscientious objectors or the people who are on the other side who want to see a population that are vaccinated? And we also, I want very quickly, I'm leaving this openly as a discursive thing, clearly, the backfire effect. I just want to delve into, what about if that backfire effect is reversed? So events can't trade, businesses can't open. So the backfire effect to them, if we have people who simply refuse to get vaccinated and continue to spread the virus unvaccinated, and then putting pressure on our NHS, who then block beds for allowing people to get in to get all the other things, all the stuff that we know is already happening. And how does the rest of the community react to a demographic who simply refuse to get the vaccine, either through hesitancy or because they don't believe it? How does that affect the majority of the community who are saying, but all you're doing is stopping everybody else from getting on with their life? And I know that's probably controversial, but I'd like to discuss it. Professor Reicher, you go first.
Okay. Well, lots of questions there. It's Christopher Dye has it perfectly right. It's Reicher. Actually, it's not Reicha. It's a guttural Polish pronunciation that I can't do. So my father always said Reicha. I mean, I'm not going to be able to answer every single question, even if we had, 3 days to do it. But I want to make two broad points. First of all, in many ways, my arguments are pragmatic. They are about what will get people to be vaccinated. I absolutely agree with you that, of course, we want more people to be vaccinated, that vaccinations, save lives. It's been estimated they save over 100,000 lives. What's more, and here I equally think this is a really important message, that if people aren't vaccinated, and indeed if people act in risky ways by not wearing masks, by not socially distancing, what they do is they create an exclusive society. They mean people who are vulnerable don't feel confident and don't feel able to go out in society. And so actually what it means is that as we reopen our society, we reopen it to some, but actually we imprison others more. And in terms of the messaging, one of the things that worked about the messaging early on in the pandemic was that it focused upon, if you like, the communal rather than the individual. It was about we rather than about I. And many people went along with restrictions that were quite onerous and quite difficult for the community. Lots of evidence, a number of studies showing that the key factor in adherence was about wanting the community to come out of things well, not about personal risk, but about communal risk. And I think that message, you talked about messaging, getting over that messaging and building norms in particular groups and particular communities that we're behaving this way so that we as a community can reopen, that even vulnerable people can go out, can go to the cinema, can go to nightclubs and so on. I think that's an absolutely central point. I think that communal framing is absolutely central. I think we've forgotten it a little bit. And I think that the messaging needs to concentrate very much on that. That's one general point. In terms of the various issues about the impact of vaccine certification, I suppose my arguments are that if you have these interventions and you moderate the scheme in such a way that people don't feel it's a form of control, then actually they're more likely to go along with it and get vaccinated in such a way that it does become safer for everyone, that the vulnerable can go out, that the venues can stay open. And the final thing I would say is I absolutely agree with you that most places are very good and have put huge efforts into making their venues safe. But then why not then make that formal? And why not show it? Because if people know that venues are safe, if they see, just like when you go into a restaurant, you see hygiene certificates that make you know that you're not going to be infected by bugs from the cooking, that actually the venue is safe, then it will give people more confidence to go out. It will give them more confidence to use the economy and be good not only for public health, but also for the economy, because more people will be using the economy. So it's a matter not only of making us safe, but making us know that spaces are safe so we can use those spaces. So I think, as I say, I think a certification scheme for venues would actually be good all round, be good for public health. It would be also good for those employers and owners who put huge efforts into making their venues safe.
Professor Day?
Just a few swift remarks to follow on from that. First, as I think you said, Mr. Fairley, safe people are not an alternative to safe venues. We should be doing both, because both together is going to have the best effect. On your other point about care homes and whose rights are important, I think that this raises a question of general importance to me, which is that the science that lies behind that, which is partly why we're here, can only take us so far. From a perspective of epidemiology, we can speak about risks to individuals and groups of people in different settings, such as care homes. But when it comes to the assessment of rights and values, that is a subjective judgment, and a subjective judgment that needs to be made by all those who are involved. So not just by one group of people, such as those people who run care homes, but by the community of people, all of whom are involved in what care homes do. So we hear a lot about, in the UK especially, following the science, but the science only takes us so far in this regard. And when it comes to the assessment of value, then that is a community-based decision, and it may be a different decision made in different sets of circumstances. Thank you.
Professor Drury.
Briefly, I might have my own views on rights, but the points I've been making are not based on rights, they're based on public health outcomes. And I think the case of the care home workers is a case in point. The difficulty they have in recruitment is a real practical problem. So the argument that might be made against mandatory vaccination for those workers is not for me about their rights. It's about, you know, what happens in terms of having a viable care home. I mean, the point about the rights of others is similar to the point made about those shielding. And in fact, it was made in the UK context, the England context, around July 19th, when many people who were shielding felt that while everybody else now had the right not to wear a mask, not to distance, they were being systematically disadvantaged and losing their freedom, losing their rights. But that, in fact, was an argument for, not in favour of this measure of vaccine passports. That was an argument in favour of other public health measures, distancing, masks, and hygiene, and so on. And I think it's quite important to remind ourselves that most public health experts say that we will still need these measures. We will still need other public health measures. And that vaccination can't do all the work. And the last point is about the kind of divide and rule point you made. Well, I think, you know, divide and rule division is a real worry. And I think it's a real worry for me as something possibly coming out of vaccine passports, of people feeling excluded and different groups feeling resentful towards others. But my understanding is that these venues that are being affected are already open. So unless I've misunderstood what the proposal is, it's not to reopen venues, it's to license or to get venues that are already open to use this scheme. So it's not a proposal that venues would not be open. So I'm not sure that being a basis for this resentment.
Sorry, Mr.
Okay,
Cayley, yeah, we have to move to Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I just have one question, actually, and I hope it will be pretty straightforward. Section 5.1 of the government evidence paper produced last night states that the scheme aims first and foremost to reduce the risk of transmission. In fact, driving vaccine uptake is ancillary to that. It's the fourth bullet point after that first one. It sort of chimes with a theme, I think, that the government is trying to strike in its case, and that is that these COVID ID cards, the vaccine certification, is in and of itself a tool of infection control. When I asked the First Minister to respond to the fact that there were 5,000 cases occurring at an event that required vaccine passports, she stated that without those passports, transmission would have been worse. She presented this as indisputable fact. Can I ask, starting with Professor Stephen Reicher, because you're leaving, is that fact? Would it have been worse were we not to have vaccine certification at that event?
I mean, it's terribly difficult to deal with those counterfactuals. So the simple answer to that is, I don't know, but I can point to the issues that are important. And so in terms of the balance of risks, when you come to the issue which we've been discussing at great length of vaccine take-up, you have an advantage with the indifferent, but you have a disadvantage with those who lack trust. So there's that balance to be made. when it comes to the issue of transmission, on the one hand, it is indisputable that those who are vaccinated are less likely to be infected and less likely to transmit. We don't know exactly how much. That's indisputable. What we don't know is about whether people's sense of invulnerability, potential sense of invulnerability, leads to more risky behaviours. Now, as I say, there is some evidence that when people were first vaccinated, they began to act in more risky ways. There was evidence from Israel that that was happening, and there was evidence actually in the UK that over 80s were going out and socialising more, which is a rather nice image. But nonetheless, it led to more the potential of more transmission, because the simple fact is the more contacts we have, the more transmission there will be. Now, we can't say absolutely what vaccine passports will do upon behaviour, because in large part that also is a matter of communication. And that's why the issue of communication and messaging is so important. I think John Drury's point is an absolutely essential one. We misunderstand the pandemic, and it is not helpful to see things in binary terms. You know, either the vaccine works or it doesn't work. Either the vaccine breaks the link to hospitalization or it doesn't. It doesn't make us safe, it makes us safer. And it's really important to message in ways that if you get vaccinated, but then behave more riskily. So let's say that the vaccine biologically makes you half as likely to get infected, but you then go out and you see twice as many people, in the end, you've lost the vaccine advantage. So behavior is critical, and the messaging is absolutely critical. Where the First Minister is indisputably right is at a biological level, the vaccine makes you safer. We've got to make sure, and the way it's introduced has got to make sure, that we send the messages which make sure that that isn't undermined by behaviours which are more risky.
Can I extend that to Professor Dye?
Yes, I broadly agree with all of that, of course. It's never possible to say with regard to one particular instance or one particular event what would otherwise have happened. But it's clear where the balance of probabilities lies. And I think it's clear that vaccine certification is a way of increasing the safety of events like that. In other words, there would probably be less transmission under circumstances of vaccine certification. With regard to, just very briefly, on risk compensation, of course, I take the point that that could happen in society at large, but one would have to imagine how would risk compensation among people who are vaccinated doing riskier things, for example, take place in a particular nightclub or a bar or whatever it might be. It seems to me that that might not be so important under those circumstances, because people do what they do in nightclubs. So by and large, I think the First Minister is right in terms of the balance of probabilities, but it's impossible to speak about what might have happened at any particular single event.
Before I bring in Professor Drury, can I just ask you, Professor Drury, considering you've spoken to behavioural science in this quite extensively, given the quite significant coverage that the vaccine already enjoys across the United Kingdom, is there a tipping point at which an event like the Board Masters event in Cornwall that we're discussing, where there were 5,000 infections, that the benefits of people evidencing their vaccinated status versus the risks of them dispensing with some of the precautions and indulging in riskier behaviour because of that means that actually it's more of a liability than an asset to ask for COVID certification? I think you're on mute, Professor Drury. You're okay now? Yeah, I think we can hear you.
So, on the specific question of the venue, I'm not an epidemiologist, so I can't comment on that. I mean, I do understand that all the published studies on the reduction in transmissibility provided by the vaccine are pre-Delta, and we're talking about Delta, so there's even more uncertainty. On the balance of risks, again, it's not easy to give an answer to that, because it relates to what Stephen Reich said about, you know, the consequences and how many and how much risk behaviour follows from people's understanding of what it means to be vaccinated. So I can't really give an answer to that.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Can I thank the witnesses for their evidence and giving us their time this morning. If witnesses would like to raise any further evidence with the committee, they can do so in writing and the clerks will be happy to liaise with you about how to do that. I will now suspend the meeting to allow a changeover of witnesses. Members are advised that there is time to have a short comfort break during the suspension and we will resume at 10:15. Thank you. Thank you. We'll now move to agenda item number 3, which is a ministerial statement on COVID-19. I welcome John Swinney, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery, Dr. Gregor Smith, Chief Medical Officer, and Elizabeth Sadler, Deputy Director, COVID Ready Society from the Scottish Government. Thank you for your attendance this morning. Deputy First Minister, would you like to make any remarks before we move on to questions?
Thank you, Convener. If I could make some opening remarks, I'm grateful to the committee for the opportunity to appear once again. On Tuesday, the First Minister set out a number of updates in relation to COVID on the rules on international travel and on promoting better ventilation, including the immediate step to make up to £25 million of additional funding available to support business to enhance ventilation. The focus of what the First Minister said on Tuesday was on the COVID certification scheme, and the Scottish Government takes the position that the implementation of a mandatory domestic certification scheme is proportionate and appropriate at this point in the pandemic. Recent data has been a stark reminder of the challenges that we continue to face as a nation. Getting vaccinated remains the single most important thing any of us can do to help cases to remain under control. We've seen considerable efforts from businesses and individuals to step up compliance to mitigation measures that remain in place. That remains crucial to how we emerge from the pandemic. In line with our strategic intent to suppress the virus to a level consistent with alleviating its harms while we recover and build for a better future, the COVID-19 vaccination certification scheme will allow us to meet the following aims: to reduce the risks of transmission, to reduce the risks of serious illness and death, and in so doing, alleviate pressure on the healthcare system, to allow high-risk settings to continue to operate as an alternative to closure or more restrictive measures, and to increase vaccine uptake. Last week, we set out details on how a domestic certification scheme will operate, and on Tuesday, we published detailed guidance on how we expect this to be implemented in the small range of sectors in scope. We've listened to a range of stakeholders and very much appreciate the challenges the implementation of this scheme presents. That is why we're ensuring that the enforcement measures will not take effect until the 18th of October. To be absolutely clear, the expectation is that businesses adopt this scheme from the 1st of October, so we will be monitoring this closely to ensure that these requirements are being met. The interim period will allow businesses to familiarise themselves with the guidance, develop measures for enforcing COVID certification, and to test these in collaboration with local authority representatives and indeed with ministers from the Scottish Government. The Scottish Government's view is that certification can play a useful role in helping to keep case numbers low as we move into winter. We have come a long way in recent months, our economy is open, and we're seeing a relative return to normality. Partnership has been key to this, and I ask businesses and individuals to continue with this endeavour in the coming weeks to ensure we're all doing all that we can collectively to recover from the ill effects of the pandemic. This afternoon, the Health Protection Coronavirus Requirements Scotland Act No. 2 regulations will be laid and will come into force from 5 o'clock tomorrow morning. I understand that in line with the usual procedure agreed with my officials for made affirmative COVID SSIs, my officials shared draft regulations with committee clerks yesterday. The regulations amended by this regulation require Scottish ministers to review the requirements at least once every 21 days, and the regulations require Scottish ministers to revoke any requirement as soon as it is no longer necessary. I look forward to
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. Could I ask the first question? I wonder if you could comment on the indicators that the Scottish Government intends to use to monitor the implementation of the vaccination certification scheme.
What we intend to do is to monitor the pattern of the pandemic as we have done on a consistent basis up until now. So the key indicators that we look at are in relation to the daily cases, the age breakdown within those, the levels of hospitalisation, the demand on intensive care units, and to apply that also to the wider modelling of the pandemic to determine what is the effect that all of these measures are having within our within the handling of the pandemic and the scale of the challenge that we face. And obviously that enables the government to formulate a view about what measures remain proportionate, because that is the key test that the government must continue to fulfil to ensure there is legal foundation to the approach, but fundamentally to enable us to make a judgment about the course of the pandemic and the measures that we require to take to take the necessary intervention.
Thank you. Can I ask what are the key indicators you'll be looking for to determine whether the scheme is working as intended? I also wondered how the businesses, organisation and the public will be able to provide feedback on the implementation of the scheme, and will you publish this information as part of the three-week review process?
I'm certainly very happy to consider what material we can helpfully publish to demonstrate the response and the reaction to the measures. We publish a huge amount of data on a regular basis, but if the committee wishes to specify and stipulate areas where it believes the publication of data would be of assistance, I would be very happy to consider what would be able to be published in that context.
Thank you. Just a last question. The committee's received correspondence from a member of the public who was a volunteer participant in the Stage 3 Novavax trial in Aberdeen that took place in December last year. He claims the NHS England has registered all 13,000 volunteers, but no participants have been registered in Scotland. Firstly, do you recognise these figures? And secondly, what contact has the Scottish Government had with the vaccine trial participants to hear their concerns and to address them?
I'll maybe invite Dr. Smith, the Chief Medical Officer, to comment on that. What I would say is that, I'd be very happy to consider the letter that has come from the member of the public and to try to address the issues that have been raised. It is important that individual cases are looked at properly. The second point I would make is that we have written to those who have been involved in vaccine trials to provide them with the assurance that they will be exempt from the COVID certification arrangements. But if there is a particular issue that has arisen as part of that process that we haven't taken account of, I would be very happy to do so. But perhaps Dr. Smith would like to give more detail.
So the first thing I'd like to say is a big thank you to everyone who's participated in these trials. They've been enormously important in terms of giving us the knowledge and the confidence to be able to move forward with an incredibly successful vaccine programme that we have done. And we're eternally grateful to everyone who's participated in those. There are some specific trials which are still ongoing. And within those trials, of course, there are trial protocols that mean that people are blinded and perhaps don't know whether they've had a particular type of vaccine or if they've had a placebo as well. What we have committed to and we have done to this stage is for those people who are participating in trials in Scotland, the principal investigators of those trials have written to each of the participants with a particular letter that they can use in the same circumstances as certification is currently employed, just, if you like, a letter of comfort that shows these people are involved in trials and should be treated as though they are vaccinated. Where it becomes just a little bit more challenging and where there are international discussions is how those certification pieces are recognised on an international basis, received by other countries. It's not unique to the UK just now. Every country is currently working through some of the challenges that are in that area, but we continue to liaise with our colleagues in the UK government to how we might kind of achieve a solution to that.
Right, thank you. Can I move to Meadow Fraser, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I have a large number of questions I would like to ask, but if your time constraints will only allow me to ask a fraction of them, but we'll see how we get on. And this is based on the draft regulations that we got yesterday afternoon and the evidence paper. Can I start by asking about the issue of allowing negative PCR tests as an alternative to proof of double vaccination? Now, you say at paragraph 5.1 of your evidence paper, Scotland will be the only European country that will adopt a vaccine-only certification scheme with no option to provide a negative PCR or antigen test result or proof of recovery from a previous COVID-19 infection within a predetermined time period. We also heard an evidence this morning from experts, including Professor Dury, who talked about the backfire effects of requiring vaccine certification, how this might actually depress vaccine take-up amongst those who are already vaccine hesitant. Given that, and given that every other European country allows testing as an alternative, why was this not considered by the Scottish Government?
It has been considered by the Scottish Government, and we came to the judgment that the core purpose of the scheme was to encourage the improvements in take-up of the vaccine. So therefore, we felt that on balance, and I accept that on almost all of the questions that we wrestle with in relation to COVID, we are wrestling with questions on balance, because there is never a crystal clear position to be adopted. The benefits of concentrating the scheme on a purpose of increasing vaccine take-up rates would be potentially undermined by an alternative route of testing evidence being demonstrated. So that's the judgment that we arrived at on that question, and because we did not want to undermine the vaccine take-up approaches. We have, of course, said that we will continue to consider the issue of whether a testing approach can be added to the arrangements that were put in place. So we haven't ruled it out for all time, but we have taken a view that as we introduce the scheme with the express purpose of boosting vaccination rates, we should not adopt the approach that Mr. Fraser has put to me.
Okay, thank you for that. We also heard this morning in evidence from Professor Dye, and indeed others, that these backfire effects he referred to might be minimised if there were in the provisions for vaccine certification some form of criteria set down whereby they would be time limited. So if people could see an endpoint, that would remove the potential distrust amongst vaccine hesitant groups. Is that something the Scottish Government have looked at?
I suppose I would say that there are two aspects to that. I accept the point that time-limited restrictions and constraints are beneficial, because everybody wants to feel as if we're not in this forever, that there is an end point to this. So I completely accept that point, which is why on a number of the arrangements, you know, at a statutory level about COVID restrictions, we do have endpoints when regulations will naturally fall as a consequence. The second point is, of course, that there is a three-weekly review of whether this carries on, and that three-weekly review will have to be tested against the judgment of whether it remains a proportionate intervention. So the government every 3 weeks is going to have to demonstrably show why this remains a proportionate measure to be in place. So I would hope that would perhaps address some of the legitimate points that the committee has heard this morning, because I do think the public needs to hear a message that this has only been done for a certain set of circumstances and for a certain purpose, and that will not last forever. So I hope that helps to address some of those points.
We've got time for one more question. One more question. Okay, thank you, Camilla. In the Court of Session yesterday, James Muir was appearing for the Scottish Government. Now, according to reporting by the BBC's Philip Zim, who's an excellent court reporter, he told the court that there was ample time for the government's evidence paper to be considered by all parties before the vaccine passport scheme is actually enforced on the 18th of October, rather than when the regulations come into force tomorrow. I don't understand what that comment is supposed to mean, because the regulations come into force tomorrow, they have been made. Was he intending to mean that the Scottish Government might review this before the 18th of October or withdraw these regulations, or what did he mean?
I think Mr. Muir means what he says, which is my experience of Mr. Muir on all of these occasions, which is that the regulations come into force tomorrow morning at 5 o'clock, but they will not be enforced until the 18th of October. And I think Mr. Muir was simply trying to make a helpful point to the court, which was that the evidence paper is available and can be considered by any interested party. I would also make the point that I know there's been quite a lot of discussion around the publication of an evidence paper, and I think it's important to remember that on a very regular basis, the government publishes a report on the state of the pandemic, and no sort of studied observer of that report could come to any conclusion other than the fact that we face an ongoing, very challenging and acute situation in relation to the handling of the pandemic. So my contention would be that there is evidence marshalled on a very regular basis. The state of the pandemic report, I think, is issued weekly. So on a weekly basis, we are publicly expressing what we think to be the scale of the challenge that we face, therefore providing the evidence base for why we need to take action. You know, we're taking other actions. We maintain a position that face coverings have got to be worn in indoor settings, in public places and public transport and shops and all the rest of it. We encourage physical distancing, a whole variety of different interventions based on the evidence that we've marshalled and communicated publicly.
Lots more I'd like to ask, Convener, but I'm afraid we don't have time.
Thank you. Alex Rowley.
Thank you. Can I quickly do a question on vaccine passports before moving on? The evidence this morning that we received, and interestingly the expert panel by and large, I think, said that they thought the paper that was published yesterday was fairly good. But they say that by putting a date on when this could perhaps finish can backfire. What they suggested was an end criteria where you set out a criteria. Yeah, so is that something, just briefly, that the government would be interested in looking at?
Well, I would contend, Mr. Rowley, that is exactly what the government has done by recognising, and I've confirmed that again to committee this morning, that the government can only sustain these regulations if there is a proportionate justification for doing so. And that is essentially, I think, the answer to the question that the witnesses were expressing to committee this morning, and the point that Mr. Rowley fairly puts to me in his question, that we cannot say, I can't sit here and say these will be in place until a given date, because the state of the pandemic could improve to an extent where I did not have the justification for so doing. So I can't say to Mr. Rowley they will be here until X, because every 3 weeks, that would essentially be me prejudging the 3-weekly review that we have to undertake. Now, the likelihood is that we expect cases to be high, that hospitalisation to remain high, and that is putting great pressure on the system, which is why we need to take steps to suppress the prevalence of the virus, and the best way to do that is to increase uptake in vaccination. And I hope that helps to address the point.
I think so. I think I took for what they said that you know, there'd be a criteria where you would set out that hospital admissions due to COVID were down to zero or down to whatever.
I see.
And I think it's a criteria, so you have something to work towards rather than a specific date, and it probably makes more sense to take that approach.
But I hope if I could just add that, yeah. I think I don't want in any way to sound as if I'm disagreeing with Mr. Rowley, because actually I think that is the approach we're taking, but we express it slightly differently in the legal test of proportionality, because if we find ourselves in a situation where there is not a sustainable legal case to be made for the proportionality of these regulations, the government will have to deal with that.
Okay, but I want to move on to what I think is a much more pressing issue in terms of the public, and that is, the more I speak to people working within our NHS or health and community services, the more concerned I become that our ability to cope this winter is immense. The pressure on staff, the pressure on these services is immense. And I raised on Tuesday with the First Minister the issue of home care and community care services. And it seems to me that, for what I can see, the waiting times are grown and grown and grown for people living in the community who need home care support, the numbers of people assessed are as needing care and on waiting times. The waiting times is going up and the numbers is going up. That will have a very clear impact on accident and emergency as many of these people find that the only route forward. And more widely, community care services supporting older people in the community. These services are all under pressure. And the question I asked the First Minister, and I think I'd like to ask yourself, because I met with NHS Fife last week, and they were keen to stress to me that this is not just a Fife problem, that this is right across the country. But what was not clear to me was where the solutions lie. And therefore, do we need a task force that can start to look at the level and extent of the problems that are existing within community care and actually start to look at what we're going to do to address that, the here and now, given if we don't address it, the problems are going to become even significantly greater as we get into the winter with massive pressure on our hospitals?
There's a lot in that question, Convener, and I think, frankly, Mr. Rowley summarises the dangers and the challenges really very acutely. As of the 28th of, that's yesterday, there were 1,581 delayed discharge patients in our hospitals in Scotland. Now, if we go back to the period of the pandemic, and I know this is a very controversial issue, but there was sustained efforts taken to ensure that patients who did not require to be in hospital in the spring of 2020 were discharged to other settings. And that number, if my memory serves me right, Dr. Smith might help me out here, I think came down to about 700 at its lowest.
I would need to check back.
Yeah, just I don't have that number immediately in front of me, but my recollection was delayed discharge came down from about 1,581 where it was yesterday to about 700, which created space in our hospitals to deal with the upsurge in COVID patients. So our hospitals are congested just now, I accept that. And within that congestion, there are 1,581 delayed discharge patients. So a proportion of those could go to home settings if the appropriate level of care packages were available for them. I am of the view, and I'm pretty satisfied with this view, that the problem about the availability of care home packages is not the availability of money to provide for those care home packages, it's the availability of personnel to deliver the care home packages. And that is about the shortage of people we have in our country able to be employed just now. We have lost people from the workforce because of Brexit that have returned to other countries. As a consequence of that, we have fewer people available for employment. Unemployment is sitting at 4%. Furlough ends today. We will see what the effects... my apologies, the 28th was Tuesday. So furlough ends today. We'll obviously see the effect of that in relation to unemployment, but the estimations are that we do not expect a significant impact on unemployment as a consequence of the ending of furlough. Now, what that therefore means is that we have got to do one or two of two things. Firstly, we've got to try to maximise the number of people that we can activate to enter the labour market to try to deliver the type of care services that Mr. Rowley talks about. Or secondly, we've got to come to a different position on free movement of individuals, because the abolition of free movement has been a disaster for the labour market in Scotland. It was predicted, and it's a disaster. Now, these issues are not new issues. Lord McConnell, when he was First Minister in the early part of this century, rightly, in my view, highlighted the dangers of Scotland's population falling below 5 million and the population profile essentially weighing more towards the older population and the economically inactive. Free movement in 2004 essentially addressed those issues for the labour market in Scotland, and it's just been taken away, and it is now creating real difficulty. And the point that Mr. Rowley highlights is a significant threat to our ability to manage our way through the winter, because we simply cannot get people out of hospital and into their homes because the care packages can't be supported because there aren't enough people to do so. Now, lastly, forgive me for giving such a long answer, but it's a big question that Mr. Rowley has raised with me. Mr. Rowley raises the question of, is a task force necessary? We're straying into portfolio territory for a couple of my colleagues, Mr. Yousaf and Ms. Robertson, but I'm certainly open to finding that, you know, these issues are being focused on in our dialogue with local government and with health boards on a daily basis. And I, if there is another means or channel, to assure Mr. Rowley these issues are being addressed, and I have no criticism of the engagement of different public bodies in this process, but if we need to think about another mechanism and device to try to do that, such as a task force, then I'm very open to that question.
I'll just make a brief point. The issue for me is not just about bed blocking and people being able to get home care packages to get out of hospital. It's the number of older people that are living in the community that are being assessed as needing support to live in the community and being put on waiting lists. And those waiting lists are growing and growing. I visited yesterday Kinross Day Centre, who do a brilliant job, supported financially by Perth and Kinross Council, do a brilliant job of supporting older people in the community, bringing them in for lunch, getting lunch to them, etc. If that level of support in the community is not available, those older people will end up at the door of the accident emergency. That's the key point I'm making. It's much wider than just bed blocking. It's the whole of social care and community care, in my view, is buckling at the seams, and we need to focus on it. That would be my only point. Thanks, Convener.
I think the points that I made were designed to address exactly the situation that Mr. Rowley faces, because this is not just about a compartmentalised A&E problem, if we express it that way. This is a whole system challenge, because there aren't enough people. So the legitimate cases that Mr. Rowley raises about people who could be much better supported if they were able to get to a day centre with a wee bit of care in their home as well and all this, that, you know, their entire quality of life would be better as a consequence than perhaps being in a setting that is not appropriate or suitable for them. And the reason why that is not able to be delivered is because we are severely constrained in the availability of people to deliver such services. But I assure the committee that is the government is preoccupied by trying to address that.
Thank you. Can I move on to Jim Fairley now, please?
Thank you, Convener. I'd just like to say that my initial concerns about this passport scheme when they were first announced have been, by and large, allayed. I'm now comfortable with where we are, even more so with the fact that the panellists this morning all gave a good account of the evidence paper that was released yesterday. But what did come up this morning and does still concern me is that the passport hesitancy from certain demographics, it's the messaging and how we get to them. Because my attention now is not turning to having the passport. I'm comfortable with having the passport. Where my concern is now is that there's a demographic within our community who are not engaging with the process, and by them not engaging, they put themselves at risk and they put greater society at risk. So my question to the government is, what are you going to do, or what are you doing about your messaging and getting into these communities where people are genuinely concerned? And I take the point that they made this morning is we cannot treat people as though they are some other because they have a problem with getting a vaccine. How are we getting to these people to make them trust the system in the first place?
I think, Convener, it's important to look at this in two different ways. There is the COVID certification scheme, which has as one of its purposes to increase take-up of the vaccine. It is, however, not the only tool in the box. The other tools in the box, is my second point, is that we've got to have very tailored communication and dialogue with particular sectors of our society where there is a challenge in relation to the vaccine take-up. So that's about trying to make sure that, for example, respected figures or voices within a particular community make the case for vaccination, and there are many people in specific communities who have been encouraged to do that and are doing that. It's also about making sure that vaccine availability is practical and conceivable for communities. So if vaccine availability is for somebody who's living in poverty, if the vaccine availability is an expensive public transport journey away to get it, then it's unlikely they're going to get it. So we have got to take the vaccination to those individuals. And there's a lot of work been done in making sure that vaccine buses, all sorts of other type of approaches, enable vaccination programmes to be taken right into communities to enable that to be the case. So I wouldn't want the committee to take the view that the government only views the vaccine certification scheme as a means of encouraging take-up. There are a variety of other interventions which are about messaging, practical measures, and wider targeting of communications to enable that to be the case.
Thank you.
John Mason.
Thanks very much, convener. The point was made at the previous session by one of the experts that at one point we had thought that 70% vaccination would be enough to give like herd community for the whole community, for the whole society. Is there now a figure? I think that's now realised to be too low. Is there a target figure we're going at, A, for the whole population, but B, also for minorities, as Mr. Fairley's been saying, who haven't got it yet?
I think I'll maybe invite Chief Medical Officer to respond to that question.
So the concept of population immunity is whereby you and I getting a vaccination actually protect someone else as well, because the likelihood of us being able to then pass on infection diminishes as a consequence of that. And there were some early calculations based on the early virus type that we saw that suggested 70 to 75% may be enough if you add that into a natural exposure in the country to kind of begin to develop that population immunity. And the unfortunate truth is that with the arrival of Delta, that was blown out the water. The original virus, the original wild type, which came from Wuhan, had probably had an R number of somewhere in the region of two and a half to four, whereas Delta is estimated to have an R number, a raw R number of probably closer to six. And that makes the achievement of that population immunity in that context much, much more difficult because it's so much more transmissible. And the virus is probably as well showing some signs of escape properties that allow it to go beyond the vaccination protection as well. Although that's marginal, that's marginal. So where we are just now is that achieving that population level immunity is very difficult to actually even estimate just now because we don't have the full estimate of what the unadulterated raw R numbers are for the Delta virus. But we could say with confidence that it's likely to be very much higher than with either the original virus or even Alpha. And it's more likely to be certainly above 85 and 90% if it's achievable at all on a whole population basis.
Okay, that's helpful. Thanks very much. Can I ask, maybe this one's for yourself, Mr. Swinney, if we didn't have the vaccine certificates, what would we need to do? So, for example, if nightclubs weren't to have certificates, would we just close all the nightclubs at midnight? And if 10,000 was the limit, would we just put a limit on all crowds of 10,000?
Obviously, we've had to demonstrate reluctantly over the course of the last 18 months the type of restrictions that have been put in place on the liberties and activities of our fellow citizens. So I think the range of interventions that are available are quite clearly understood by members of the public. It does undoubtedly come down to restrictions of sectors and opening hours and all of the other measures with which colleagues will be familiar. What we are trying to do is to take an approach which enables sectors to remain open. And when we look at the case numbers that we have and the hospitalisation levels that we have are really a very serious threat. You know, I've rehearsed with Mr. Rowley this morning the challenges in our healthcare system because of the levels of hospitalisation. We still have, as of yesterday, over 1,000 people in hospital with COVID. So we can't just wish that away. That's the hard reality which is causing the challenges in the healthcare system. Levels of cases, although thankfully lower today than they were a couple of weeks ago, are much, much higher than was the case at different stages during the pandemic when we had communities locked down. In fact, Mr. Mason represents the City of Glasgow. City of Glasgow had a rate per 100,000, which, you know, I think we were locking down Glasgow at 300 per 100,000, and its case rate per 100,000 will be in excess of that today, obviously, because the vaccine provides us with a certain amount of protection. But it can't provide us with total protection, which is why we have to have tempering effects, which then try to moderate the effect of the virus. So our efforts, the COVID certification scheme, one of its motivations is to keep sectors open that in any other circumstances would be likely to have to close because of the prevalence of the virus.
Okay, I'll leave it at that just now.
Thank you. Ryan Whittle.
Thank you, Gavina. Good morning, Deputy First Minister, and those here to help. This morning we heard that one of the key successes for vaccine passports is going to be community engagement. But we heard from yourself, Deputy First Minister, 3 weeks ago that there was no public or business consultation prior to declaring the intention of implementing the vaccine passport, because you didn't want that to become public knowledge that you were considering this. So can I ask how the Scottish Government gathered the evidence on passport vaccine potential effectiveness?
Well, we've gathered that by looking at international experience. We've seen examples in other jurisdictions where the application of a COVID certification scheme has significantly increased vaccine take-up. So the evidence for that has been demonstrated in other jurisdictions. One of the very strong examples of that being in France, but there are others where that has been the case. And we've obviously looked at the experience that emerged from the studies undertaken by Public Health England when the United Kingdom government was exploring some of these questions around the access to events process, which was undertaken in the course of this year, actually. So earlier on this year, Public Health England undertook that work for the United Kingdom government, and obviously we've looked at some of the research material there, and a lot of that is charted in the evidence paper that was published yesterday.
I think one of the things we heard this morning was that, for example, in France, they didn't have a vaccine passport. They also took evidence of previous infection as well. And I think what they suggested this morning was the comparison with other schemes in other countries. We have to be careful how we utilise that data because it's going to be specific to the country. And even in your own evidence paper, it did say the impact in Israel is unclear. Because one of the things we've heard in evidence in this committee, as alluded to by Jim Fairley, was that one of the main barriers to uptake of the vaccine, which is what the vaccine passport is for, is within the ethnic minority, especially around Polish and on our African communities and around areas of deprivation. And I wonder what evidence, where the evidence suggests that the introduction of a vaccine passport will have a positive impact on those communities, because those communities are the ones that are the hardest to reach at the moment with this particular issue.
Well, I think quite a lot of this I covered in my response to Mr. Fairley, because I see this as the COVID certification as one part of a two-part strategy. I can't give Mr. Whittle a tangible number of members of the Polish community or the black and minority ethnic community that will be vaccinated, that will have vaccination as a consequence of COVID certification. But what I am confident about is that if we make sure that scheme plus measures to reach those communities in a direct, focused, targeted way, with messaging from within the community, with practical availability of access to vaccine services available, we can get to a point whereby we are increasing vaccination levels in those communities and in other communities, particularly to make sure that amongst younger people and those who are using higher risk settings, that we are ensuring the take-up is maximised to the greatest extent possible.
I think the point here I'm trying to make, Mr. Swinney, is we government use the number of the percentage of the population that is vaccinated, but when you drill down into those figures, you find that predominantly the Indigenous population in Scotland is highly vaccinated, in fact, more vaccinated than you perhaps would have expected at the start, but there are pockets within our communities that aren't high vaccination. So that in terms of when you're implementing a vaccine passport, my problem is that I'm not convinced that you have the evidence that suggests that using vaccine passports at nightclubs and football matches will actually impact those that require it the most. I agree with you that community engagement is really, really important, but that vaccine passports will not impact those to the level that you would want.
Well, I think that's. I fear that we're not going to have a meeting of minds on that particular question, because I think if I look at vaccine uptake, let me make a sweeping generalisation that people below the age of 39 are more likely to be in nightclubs than people of my vintage. I'm afraid to break that solemn news to Mr. Whittle. He won't be bumping into me in a nightclub. But the levels of vaccination below the age of 39 are comparatively lower than those above that age group. So part of the approach about COVID certification is to try to say to people, here is a, this is a further incentive to get vaccinated to make sure you can enable yourself to participate in these activities. Now, obviously, there are a large number of people of different ages go to some of the other settings, like football matches, where I accept that, it's a much broader age demographic that go to football matches. But if we approach this, and I would encourage colleagues to think of it in this way, as one part of a two-part strategy, who we accept, and I don't dispute Mr. Whittle's point about making sure that we have targeted, focused interventions for people living in deprivation, people in the black and minority ethnic community, for people from other social groups that are low take-up, that we really, really concentrate our efforts on doing that. And I pay tribute to the vaccinators for what they're doing to try to do all of that. Then we will get to the point that Mr. Mason puts to us, that we've got vaccination levels at such a height they are providing us with protection within the population, or as much protection as we can have.
Very quick point, to be fair, Cabinet Secretary, you probably won't find over 70s from the African community in nightclubs either, but their vaccination rate is 20% lower than the average. But we're not going to have a meeting of minds. The meeting of minds here is the fact that I don't believe that the evidence you suggested you had 3 weeks ago, that you're backfilling that evidence now establish the need for a vaccine passport. So that's probably the point I'm making.
Well, on that point, I think if Mr. Whittle was to look back at the state of the pandemic evidence papers published on a weekly basis over the course of the last 6, 10, 12, 20 weeks, he would see the same evidence base emerging of the challenges that we face. And the question that flows from that is, what do we do in a changing pandemic to
to address those circumstances and ideally avoid the type of scenarios that Mr. Mason put to me, that there might have to be wider restrictions applied on the way in which particular sectors are operating.
To take this debate wider, but unfortunately, I think we've got no time. I'll step back at you.
Thank you. Graeme Simpson.
Thanks very much, Convener. What level of vaccination rates do we need to get to in order for you to drop this scheme?
That's a difficult question for me to answer, because we have to weigh up a range of factors in the discussion of the proportionality of the scheme, because that will not, as Mr. Simpson will be familiar, we've tended not to have one particular indicator that judged performance at any given time. There's a basket of information we have to look at. I've cited principally that we have to look at cases, levels of hospitalisation and levels of vaccination. I think those three factors provide us with a reasonable assessment of where are we and how are we performing. And it's within the condition of those three indicators that we have to make a judgment, principally about the proportionality of any intervention that we make. And it's not just about COVID certification. If I give another example, when the schools returned in August, we said that we would, regrettably, require pupils in the secondary sector to wear face coverings for a period we thought of 6 weeks. Because of the prevalence of the cases, particularly amongst younger school-age population, we had to say, regrettably, that's going to have to extend for another period. But we judged that to be a proportionate act based on segmentation of information around case numbers.
So you won't say, or you can't say, what level of vaccinations you wish to get to. Will you be in a position at any point to give the public some, you know, your thinking on the number of cases and the vaccination rates, that whole suite of things that you've just mentioned, so that we know what we're aiming for?
Well, I think what the best thing I can say to that is that I think we know what we're aiming for, and we're aiming to suppress the virus to a position whereby we can get on with normal life. So if we get good levels of compliance on the baseline measures that we have in place, and I think actually my sense is that there's been a significant upsurge in recent weeks of compliance with baseline measures, which I think is helping to suppress levels, and I thank members of the public for that. We can come to a judgment about the proportionality. Now, Mr. Simpson asked me, when can we do that? Well, on a weekly basis, the First Minister is updating Parliament. Cabinet looks at these issues on a weekly basis. We are taking stock every single week about, is there an ongoing justification for these measures? At Cabinet on Tuesday, we took the view that there was an ongoing justification, but there was no justification for going any further beyond the COVID certification scheme. So we're looking at that on a weekly basis, plus we've got the formal 3-weekly reviews that are reported to Parliament.
Oh, OK. The problem with all that, and I'm not asking you to respond to this, is that we have nothing to... The rest of us have nothing to judge you against, because you won't say what it is you're aiming at. I want to ask about something else. And this is a real concern of mine. It's about privacy. So if my daughter goes to a nightclub tomorrow, I'd be astonished if that ever happened, actually. But if she does, and she has to show a QR code, up pops her name, her date of birth, and anyone could then find out where she lives, and I think, and find out stuff about her. I think that is an awful breach of privacy, and potentially puts people in at some risk.
I would certainly want to assure Mr. Simpson. I'm happy to. I don't know if it might help if I was to provide Mr. Simpson with the opportunity to, and the committee, I should offer the committee, if the committee wished to have a more detailed briefing with the officials and the teams who have developed the app, forgive me, I'd be very happy to arrange that, if that would help to reassure members about some of the issues and the practicalities at another stage. I'm very happy to make that available.
I'm not a member of the committee, but the point I'm making is it's the information that is given to a complete stranger, be it a nightclub or a football match, at this point, name and date of birth, at a later point, just your name, but even just your name. Why should a complete stranger know your name, they've seen your face, and then be able to look you up?
But I think for certain circumstances that will happen in other environments. If I go to an airport and I have to show my passport, I'm showing it to a complete stranger, and they'll know my name, they'll know my date of birth, my passport number.
Sorry, if I could just come in as well. With nightclubs, you do need to show identification of your driver's license when you go into nightclubs. So usually the stewards would see that as you go into nightclubs.
Well, I'm delighted that the convener's knowledge of nightclubs has come to my assistance. But I think there's a very serious point that Mr. Simpson raises, and if it would help, I'll reflect on this as to whether there's perhaps a way members of Parliament can be briefed about the approach, to try to reassure Mr. Simpson about the issues that he raises. I totally understand the sensitivity that he has on this question.
It's a data protection and issue. I
wouldn't for a moment trivialise the significance of the issues that are raised.
Do I have time for one more? Very quick. I was just reading through the draft regulations. Correct me if I've misread this, but it looks to me like cinemas are exempt.
They are.
Yeah. But theatres aren't.
Please.
So theatres are live entertainment, so they are technically within scope. However, the scope also has to take account of the capacity limits. So it would only be a theatre which was over 10,000 people. So in practice, they're not within scope.
So it'd have to be a big theatre.
Sorry?
So if it's a small theatre, it would
not
be exempt.
Scope. That's no.
Right. Okay.
Because it has to be. So it's only indoor settings of 500 or more people who are mainly standing, so that wouldn't include a theatre, or indoor settings over 10,000 people with live events, so it would only, that would I think take out every theatre in Scotland.
Right, so all theatres in Scotland.
Unless there's a theatre that is over 10,000 capacity.
Okay, that's useful. Okay, thank you.
To Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much. Good morning to the panel. Deputy First Minister, Meredith Fraser brought our attention to what I think is the most striking admission in the government's evidence paper published last night, that Scotland, when it introduces vaccine certification, will be the only country in Europe to bring this in isolation without the requirement for testing. And Meredith Fraser asked you about that. And I wrote down part of your answer. You said that the government did not want to undermine vaccine uptake. I just wonder, is there empirical evidence that you have from other European countries that have brought this in tandem with testing requirements to suggest that their vaccine uptake has been inhibited by that combination of measures?
I don't have any information on that point, but I would point out to Mr. Cole-Hamilton two things. Firstly, that there are other jurisdictions that are bringing in a COVID certification scheme on vaccination only, and also that the government has made a choice which is about the focus of the scheme, and the focus of the scheme is primarily to drive the increase in vaccination rates.
I'm grateful for the reply. I mean, that seems slightly at odds with the messaging in the government's own evidence paper published last night in section 5.1 in terms of the basis for introduction. The very first clause of that is about reduction of transmission. The increase in vaccine uptake is ancillary to that. It's the fourth bullet point. Now, I recognise that...
Well, I think on that point, I think there is a... Within the you know, if we increase uptake of the vaccination, we increase the degree of protection within the population, which therefore has the effect on suppressing the circulation of the virus. So, you know, we're sort of, I suspect, we're about to get into whether the chicken is following the egg or the other
I'm
way
happy,
around.
But, I'm more than happy to concede that.
I think Mr. Will Hamilton and I know what we're debating here.
Of course, and I'm happy to concede that point. I mean, my anxiety is, though, that as we've heard from eminent academics this morning, that it actually potentially drives down uptake in those hesitant groups, or rather the vaccine sceptic groups, that if they are feel browbeaten, they might not take it up. I want to move on.
Could I just add, this is actually been a point I wanted to actually reflect on from the evidence that the committee heard this morning, because I think there is one other important element that the witnesses this morning were adding to this, which was around the question of, is this being done within an environment of a trusted society? And I think the evidence generally suggests that there is a high level of trust within Scotland on the way in which COVID-related issues have been handled. And I think it's important that we acknowledge that backdrop is there to enable a scheme of this type to be applied in the fashion that I've suggested to the committee.
Okay, thank you for that. If I may, just one final area, convener, and that's about proportionality. And we heard from the Scottish Human Rights Commission last week that there is very much an anxiety that this scheme will row back our application of human rights and those ones that we have a statutory right to. And she says that, and Judith Robertson, the convener, it was very clear that it is acceptable for states to do that in times of pressing need, and obviously coronavirus is a pressing need, but if the scheme that is being introduced or the rollback of those rights can demonstrably impact on pushing down against that need. She also talked about proportionality, and you talked about proportionality. And the question I'd like to ask is that the sort of evidence of proportionality, meeting that test set to us by the Scottish Human Rights Commission, requires that the government evidence that it has considered alternatives to that scheme. Are you satisfied that you have considered the use of testing as an alternative to vaccine certification to an extent that the Scottish Human Rights Commission would be satisfied with?
Well, I obviously can't speak for the Scottish Human Rights Commission, but I do absolutely accept the tests that the Scottish Human Rights Commission would place upon us. And these matter to the government. Mr. Cole Hamilton will be familiar with the government's position on the significance of human rights in all of the activities that we take forward. He knows the legislation the government has taken through Parliament, for example, on the incorporation of the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child, so as an illustration of the government's commitment to a human rights-based approach. And indeed, the COVID recovery strategy that the government is working on focuses very much on a human rights-based approach in relation to the recovery, and it will be material to the public inquiry that takes place on COVID issues. So I don't in any way dispute the importance and significance of the human rights questions. And where I absolutely agree with Judith Robertson is that these questions are fundamentally hinge on the question of proportionality. And the government has got to be able to satisfy itself of the question of proportionality of any of the measures that it takes forward. We also, as Mr. Cole Hamilton will well know, have to satisfy ourselves that we could withstand legal challenge on any of these questions, and it's a question that the government considers very carefully on all occasions. I think in answer to the question about alternatives, the government of course looks at a range of of possible approaches that we might take. And indeed, Mr. Mason invited me to speculate on some of those as alternative measures on the restriction side. There are, of course, other arguments in relation to testing approaches, which I would contend the government is using to the maximum of our ability to ensure that those devices are being used. But we judge that a COVID certification scheme is a proportionate measure in addition to the range of other interventions that we're taking forward to suppress the virus, to increase uptake of the vaccine and to protect the public.
Thank you. I think we might just have one more brief question, if we could, please.
I'll try and be brief, Convener. I've got some specific questions around the terms of the regulation, so I'll ask one and see how we get on. There's a new power of entry contained in Regulation 16A in the draft instrument that we saw yesterday afternoon, which gives power to entry a property without warrant, where permission to enter is refused, to ensure that an offence is not being committed in terms of the regulations. And that is a power that can be exercised by a police officer or by a local authority officer. Can I ask, how does the Scottish Government foresee these regulations being enforced? And do you see a role for the police in doing this?
No, I don't. I think the approach that will be taken, and this is a habitual approach that's taken in all the settings, and I'm very happy to put on the parliamentary record that this will be the approach that will be taken. It's an approach that I have discussed with local authorities, and a very helpful discussion with local authorities on this question the other day. We will be taking an approach which is about engaging, explaining, encouraging before we get to enforcing. So the 4E's approach, with which many institutions will be familiar in relation to the work of local authority regulators, will be very much the approach that is taken. We want to work with businesses to make sure that they understand the obligations and to support them in putting in place the practical measures that they can take forward. So that will be the cultural approach that is taken, and local authorities are very keen to make sure that approach, which is very much the commonplace Scottish local authority approach, is maintained as we take this forward.
Thank you, that's very helpful. I've got time for one more quick question, Convener.
1 minute.
Okay, thank you. One other question about the draft regulations. There's a provision in the new regulation 7E, which sets out the list of exempt events. So 7E subparagraph C exempts any event designated by the Scottish ministers as a flagship event according to criteria and in a list published by Scottish ministers. But that's a very wide power being given to Scottish ministers there, and obviously we have no definition at this stage of what a flagship event is. Can you explain a bit more about what's envisaged there and what would fall under that list?
Well, it's trying to provide the appropriate opportunity for us to designate individual events that might be of a particular noteworthy nature. For example, Her Majesty the Queen is coming to Parliament on Saturday, and I would describe that as a flagship event. And now, there is no necessity for us to consider these issues because the numbers of people involved will not be appropriate. But yeah, I can envisage flagship events that we might all wish to have the appropriate opportunity and recognition to take forward. But I'll maybe invite Elizabeth Sandleton.
The committee may recall during the summer there were a number of events that were allowed to progress out with the scope of the regulations in place at the time. So that included things like the Edinburgh International Festival, some of the larger golf events where there was an exemption, where on the basis of public health advice, these events were considered to be so significant in terms of their impact on Scotland as an international place where people want to do business, that they were allowed to progress. And that is essentially, there are no events in that programme extant at the moment, but that is just to enable, if there were to be any events such as that, that they could be exempted from certification if required. But we don't have any at the moment in planning.
Okay, thank you. Much more I could ask, Convener, but I think we're out of time.
Thank you. If I can just go back to Graham Simpson's point and ask the Deputy First Minister, with the agreement of the committee, I think it could be helpful if we had a briefing, not only for the committee, for the all MSPs on the new app, if that would be possible.
I think I'll take that issue away, Convener, but I think there's a fair point to be addressed there. So let me take that away and put that into motion.
Thank you. So that concludes our consideration of this agenda item, and I'd like to thank the Deputy First Minister and his officials for their evidence today. The committee's next meeting will be on the 7th of October, and we'll take evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care on the vaccination programme and pandemic preparedness. That concludes the public part of our meeting for this morning, and I suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave. Thank you.